We're live in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV Online in association with Maharashtra Orthopedic Association Masterclass Webinar Series. To introduce today's topic and the speaker, I hand over to our president, Professor Dr. Ajit Shinde.
Thank you, Neeraj. Respected dignitaries, faculty, and my dear friends, good morning. On behalf of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, I, Dr. Ajit Shinde, President of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association and Organizing Chairman of IOCON 2021 Goa, welcome you all for the MOA Masterclass. Idea behind this masterclass is to learn latest knowledge so that words of wisdom should reach to all orthopedic surgeons, especially in the peripheral area. In last month, we discussed arthroplasty, hip and knee. In this month, we are going to discuss various topics of trauma. And today, we are going to discuss upper limb trauma on fracture dislocation of shoulder, where one must be aware of fracture anatomy and importance of CT scanning to understand fracture pattern, to anticipate the challenges of these fractures and its management to achieve best intra-articular reduction and functional outcome. It is also important to have a knowledge of surgical exposures and necessary implants to maintain the achieved reduction. We have expert panelists and faculties from across the India and Maharashtra. Today, we have our president-elect, Professor Vasudev Gaade Gune Sir from Chandrapur as a convener for this program. Professor Dr. Sangeet Gawale, who is the standing president of BOS, is as a moderator for this session. Dr. Mohan Desai, HOD KM Hospital, Mumbai. Dr. Chetan Pradhan from Sancheti Institute, Pune. Dr. Professor Asim Negi from Indore. Dr. Vivek Shetty from Mumbai. All are stalwarts from the field. Welcome, everyone. I'm sure we will have amazing lectures followed by insightful discussion. My best wishes for today's webinar, and I'm sure all these dignitaries will enlighten us on this challenging issue. Before I'm giving mic to Gaade Gune, I would like to do one announcement. This year, the 66th annual meeting of IOA, Maharashtra Orthopedic Surgeon is hosting and conducting IOCON 2021 at Goa Shama Prasad Convention Center. Already, registrations and accommodation is open from 1st of the September. Early bird benefits are up to 15 September. As there is a shortage of rooms, we have booked only 900 rooms with very reasonable rates. Those who are interested, they should book as early as possible. Whatever rate we got, we are offering to the all the delegates. I request all of you to come and attend this conference in big numbers to make it a grand success. Now, without wasting much time, I hand over mic to our convener, Dr. Gaade Gune, for further proceeding. I thank Ortho TV, Neeraj Bijlani, and Ashok Shyam for broadcasting our all programs of MOA. Thank you. Jai Hind, Jai Maharashtra, Jai MOA.
So, good morning to everybody. Now, thank you very much, Ajit Shinde sir, for your endeavor to promote the academic activities of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association. You are always with academic deliberations of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association. I teach a torch bearer throughout the India, and you are taking that torch to all over India. Thank you very much. Now, today's webinar is on a shoulder fracture dislocation. Or these are the faculties, Dr. Sangeet Gawale, Vivek Shetty, Asim Negi, Chetan Pradhan. They are all moti hai ye, shoulder fracture dislocation ke sabhi. And we have to take advantage of their knowledge so that we can improve our surgery in future, and also it will help our patient to deliver a good. Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, in the presidentship of Ajit Shinde, has given so much chance to the all faculties from the Maharashtra as well as from the faculty from all over India also. In a such an endeavor, Dr. Asim Negi from Indore, I must take his name because he is one of the finest surgeons which I found in my practice. So, Dr. Sangeet Gawale, it's over to you, and we think that something good will come out of this webinar, and it will be beneficial to not only to the a very expert orthopedic surgeon, but a surgeon those who are working at periphery also. Thank you very much, and thank you Neeraj and Ashok for giving us a chance to telecast this on Ortho TV.
Good morning all, and before we start, I must congratulate Dr. Shinde for having till now more than 65 webinars and continuing to educate all the orthopedic surgeons across Maharashtra and outside Maharashtra. We had till now almost 67 webinars under the leadership of Dr. Shinde and under the aegis of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association. I wish such academic activities should be promoted and should be continued in years to come. So coming back to the webinar today, we have chosen a topic on proximal humerus, even though it is very common, but the topics chosen are something which will be helpful for you in the clinical practice. We often miss the anterior dislocation, fracture dislocation, or the posterior fracture dislocation. What is the role of hemiarthroplasty in three-part, four-part fracture dislocations, and how to get the things right when you are fixing these fracture is a common discussion what we will have for 1.5 hours. So I invite the first speaker, Dr. Vivek Shetty, who is attached to Hinduja Hospital, excellent surgeon and academician. So he will be starting with his first talk on how to get three-part, four-part fracture right when you're fixing on day one. Over to you, Vivek. Please share your screen.
Good morning, everybody. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. Good morning. I'd like to thank Maharashtra Orthopedic Association to give me this floor to share my experience, Dr. Ajit Shinde and Dr. Gadegone. And I'd like to thank our moderator, Dr. Sangeet Gawale, for this invite on this monsoon Sunday morning. So what I'd like to share is how I go about in my practice in fixing 3- and 4-part proximal humerus fractures. So I'd like to list the indications for surgical treatment of these fractures, the 3-4-part fractures. What are the relative indications for internal fixation? We have a talk on greater tuberosity as well as anterior-posterior dislocations of shoulder where surgery is required when there is an associated fracture. I'll touch upon fixation versus arthroplasty in this age group. What are the desired outcomes? I know Professor Mohan Desai is doing a talk on hemiarthroplasty, and he'll kind of cover the arthroplasty section. So proximal humerus presents its unique challenges. You have the rotator cuff, which is important for a functional outcome when you fix. the fracture classification, there are several. We need to recognize the vascular supply, the anterior and posterior circumflex, which are the branches of the axillary. If that is injured either during the fracture or during surgical fixation, then avascular necrosis is a problem. But the more unique problem is that there are two groups of extreme groups of patients. One of them are the young patient where you need to restore their function as well as their, preserve the vascularity. And the elderly patient who are more or less happy if you give them pain relief and their functional demands are not as much. So the arthroplasty in the younger age groups do not do as well. So every attempt needs to be made to get a good fixation in these younger age groups. So these are different injury pattern in the two age groups. And what are the challenges in the elderly that we all know is we have osteoporotic bone. So therefore the implants may not as hold, though with the lac implants nowadays, we do get better function. They inherently before the fall had a restricted shoulder function either because of the degeneration or because of the muscle status and their physical demand and mental demand. They may not necessarily be able to follow the physical therapy and instruction that we are expecting of them. So these are the challenges. So depending on the fracture type, depending on what classification you choose, whether they are stable or unstable, the degree of displacement, their age, as I mentioned, and what is the expectation that the patients have, you need to match those expectations. Sometimes if you don't match their expectation, that is purely because you have not led them to, in your consultation, decided what to expect from the fixation. So as in any fracture classification or good quality x-rays, CT to know the degree of displacement, if there is a split in the head, if there is a defect, what is the bone quality? All these need to be looked at as in any other fracture. The list of treatment, you have the non-operative group. This still in my practice is a fairly sizable chunk, up to around 40 to 50% of 2 and 3 part in the elderly, I would still treat non-operatively. The minimal invasive, there may be some role here of Kerr-Kay wires. Plate osteosynthesis, intramedullary nailing, and shoulder replacement. So plate osteosynthesis and intramedullary, I will probably cover in this presentation. Non-operative treatment does not mean neglecting them. If you have a stable fracture pattern as in a valgus pattern, 2 or 3 part fracture, somebody who is very osteoporotic, your fixation might not do justice. I still in my practice kind of give them a pouch arm sling and follow them up on a regular basis to see if there is a loss of reduction. So it does not mean neglecting these fractures. It means a supervised observation and make sure that they don't go stiff and constantly radiologically monitor them. The minimal invasive, just to cover the topic, there is a risk if you're just putting Kirschner wires, there is a loss of reduction. It is potentially more biological, but the implants, they are not very stable fixations. I don't do much in the form of minimal invasive in this fashion. What about the conventional plates that have been used? There is a very high number of non-unions, plate backouts and failure rate with the 3 and 4 part with the conventional fixation. However, with the advent of the locked plate, I like to share this first patient of mine. This is going way back to 2004 when in Mumbai, the first plate, locked plate was launched, which was a T plate for the tibia. And this was a fracture and myself and Dr. Vikas Agashe, my colleague, this was my pathologist consultant's mother. This injury had come, so we all agreed this had to be fixed. And we went ahead and used this T-plate, this 4.5 screw. At that time also, we realized that we needed valgus reduction and we didn't rely entirely on the plate itself. So we used a tension band wire to reinforce. And 4 months down the line, we got solid bone union. And we like to believe that it was more due to the valgus positioning and the stability provided. Of course, the lock plate also helped. So this is my first experience in 2004 using a lock plate. Nowadays, we have our standard proximal humerus lock plate. How do I do that? We have the in a beach chair position. We have a talk on deltoid split approach to follow. I will concentrate on the deltopectoral approach. We use indirect reduction tools, lock plate, and provide the fixation of the tuberosity. So I like to take through my 6 steps of plate fixation. So this is the position that I use. I have the C-arm coming from the front It's a beach chair position. It's a deltopectoral approach. Sorry. I take a stay sutures, I identify the long head of the bicep. Stay sutures are taken through the tendon rather than through the bone on either side of the long head of the bicep. So you have my supraspinatus and the subscapularis tendon brought in. Now, you need to remember that the CCD angle is, that is, if there is a CCD angle, that is a central column diaphyseal angle of 135 degrees. That's the normal angle. That's the valgus angle that you should be aiming for. And following the fracture, because of the pull of the deltoid and the pectorals, the head drifts into varus. And therefore, you need to abduct the arm, take the tension off, lever the head out, keeping the medial head intact, and try and get the CCD angle to 135 degrees. So this is what you are trying to kind of achieve. What you need to do is get the angle corrected to valgus. And this is the old ambassador car sign. So the greater tuberosity is where is the bonnet of the car. And the chassis of the car in a right shoulder should come from 10 to 4 o'clock position. And in a left should be going from 2 to 8 o'clock position. So that's the valgus position that I'm trying to take every time, every case, whenever I'm doing a fixation. So remember, the floor of the car has to come from 10 to 4 to 2 to 8, depending on whether you're doing the right or the left shoulder. This is what I do. This is a varus position pre-op. I get my periosteum or whatever tool you want to use and try and correct and get the medial hinge intact. Now look at the angle. The motor car sign that I showed you about, that is come from almost 9:30 to 3:30. That's a good hinge. Now, remember, you have to maintain this. One of the ways is traditionally we try to pass from distal to proximal. Remember, you have the option of passing through the supraspinatus tendon as well. So the wire doesn't come in the way of your plate. That is one way. Alternatively, if the head is very mobile, you may use to maintain the reduction by passing the head K wire from the head into the glenoid. But remember, then you can't maneuver it around too much. The other picture is you can get, if it is really unstable, screw wires from below upwards as well as from top down. I have also, if you can see the shadow of a bone graft that has been put in. So sometimes if the shell is very thin and I have opted for fixation, then that is the option that I choose. But remember, the floor of the car has to be in the right shoulder from 10 to 4 o'clock. The next thing that I do is, now that you have got the head under support, then you tie the supra and the subscapularis sutures to each other so that it secures the head firmly under the rotator cuff. So that is supported in valgus. The next thing that you want to do is to get the plate in place. And some of the, there are various plates available. This is one of the plates that I use. Each of them have certain landmarks to use it from. The synthes plate is the one which you need to place about 10 millimeter posterior to the bicipital groove and make sure that superior inferiorly it is kind of placed well. Then the next thing that I do is make sure that I have got my C-arm position. So this is another trick that I use. I make sure my juniors do not flex the elbow. So this is the position in AP. Remember, the C-arm is coming from the front. I check the AP position, and if I have to go into the lateral, I just turn the arm internally at 90 degrees. The elbow is not in the way, and in the C-arm stays in the same position. And that's the view that I get in lateral position. So that's the trick that has helped me in getting my C-arm position right and making sure that the plate sits in firmly in the center. Every case, every time, that's the attempt I make. The next thing that I do is make sure that my calcar screw comes in exactly where I want it. I don't worry about too much on the superior side. At least I don't want the plate to run superiorly over the GT. So I either use the hole number D or E so that I get the calcar screw positioning so that my plate doesn't go too far proximally. So that's the plate, the screw that goes in first. The next thing that I do is my push or pull screw. Now, depending, if you have an intact medial hinge, then I use the first screw is a lock screw. I don't want it to be pulled so that the medial hinge is lost and you get varus. So depending on what, so it is not a standard thing that you put a non-lock screw and pull the shaft towards the plate. Depending on what you want, if you want, don't want the plate to come towards your the bone to come towards your plate, then put a lock screw and hold the reduction. So this screw could be either a push or a pull screw. And once you have established that, then you can kind of get the the screws which kind of I rely on my C, D and E screw. This could be my Calca screw, and I don't rely on the A screw too much. As it is, that screw is of mine is much, much short. It is a good centimeter short from the head, so that if there is a cutout, I don't want the screw cutting out first. So the A screw is always put short. But the critical screws are the C, D and E screws, which is what decides my plate positioning. So this is how I end up and try to end up with every 3-4 part fixation, and I get a decent outcome. Once I have got my plate fixed in, then I get my sutures tied over, the rotator cuff sutures back to the plate, and that reinforces the fixation. So just to show you a couple of cases, a 3-4 part fracture confirming on CT, the same principle used. Remember, the kickstand screw is the one that is holding and preventing your the collapse. The car sign here, maybe it's going towards 11 o'clock a little. So there is a little bit of loss of reduction, but that has been prevented any further. The A screws I've chosen not to put, because remember, once if it starts drifting, even in spite of all your principles used, that is the first screw to come out. So my recommendation would be put that screw fairly short. Do not try and grab the subchondral. My current practice is not to kind of go very close to the subchondral bone. I just drill and then sound the drill bit so that my screws are all a little away from the articular surface. And then I screw the screen the C-arm in various angle to make sure that none of the screws are penetrating. Another example of a 4-part fracture with in 2006, we had, some of us will remember this PHLP plate. This is a split head, therefore an anterior posterior screw was used. But again, the same principle, valgus reduction in this case, and a union at 1 year with a decent range of movement. What about additional support required? So this is a case where one of my colleagues called me, where he had taken up this case and realized there is a split head, a CT was done, and he did not have a backup of a hemiarthroplasty on the setup. And the decision was in a split head. This was the C-arm picture, how to go about it. And we decided to proceed with the fixation. We have a bone bank. We decided to take this articular cartilage off the femoral head and created a mushroom-like head. And we had a head in within head construct. We've got the car sign there, valgus position, held the graft and the head and into the glenoid, sutured the rotator cuff, and that's the position that we got in. And that's the outcome at 6 weeks. You can see the head in place, and that is at 6 months. So we got away with a decent correction. But the moral of the story is, if you are kind of worried about the head in an elderly, always have a backup of a hemiarthroplasty in case you are stuck. Another case, if you are using a stud graft, I suggest use the graft medially and not going towards the north pole, because that will not give you additional support. And hold this support with a K-wire and with your calcar screw, and you could get a decent outcome. This is another picture of a strut graft with a 1 year outcome. So these are the ways to kind of use the lock plate in various 3-4 part fractures. What are the outcomes of current lock plate? We recognize they are biomechanically better adapted to the anatomy. The implants do have their specific complication, which we'll kind of enumerate. As far as the initial displacement goes, the valgus impacted ones do well when you choose to fix, as opposed to the varus ones. These do not as well, and you need to be taking extra effort to make sure you get a valgus reduction. Overall, the outcomes are good. The rehab operation rate, if you follow the principles followed, then it is a good outcome that you can do. The risk factors in the elderly are all we are familiar with. What is in our hand is to making sure you get a valgus and anatomical reduction, restoration of the medial cortical support, either with your sutures or with your strut grafts. Because the main thing which is in our hand is, if you do not avoid the varus, then you are going to get a poor outcome. So that is the basic basis of my talk. The complications that we have in our group here is varus malunion, and that is linked to screw penetration, that is linked to loss of reduction, that is leading to cutout and impingement and the non-union. So varus is the key which is linking all the four or five complications that we normally see. Do not try and put the A screws long, because then they are the first to cut out. So remember, try and make that short. some cases of complication. Again, this is a 72-year-old male fixed elsewhere. And this is a CT picture showing a three-part fracture. The fixation has been done in a various position. Remember the car, in this case, it is going from 1 o'clock to 5:30 position. So that's the problem. And by 4 months, this was the screws were cutting out. The MRI picture showed that the supraspinatus was defunctional. And therefore, we opted to kind of, I decided to do a reverse shoulder. Now, the idea of showing this is not that a reverse shoulder was done. The idea was to show that a simple, straightforward fracture, if you do follow the fixation principles, you should not reach the shoulder replacement stage. So you need to kind of follow the, this is in our control. The osteoporotic nature of the bone and the rotator cuff function is not in our hands, but at least the fixation principles are. So that is something that we need to do. This is one of my cases, a case, gentleman who fell off the stage in 2007. This was a picture, very badly fractured shoulder dislocation. I'm kind of invading my next speaker's territory of a shoulder dislocation, but I thought it will be an interesting case just to show. In 2007, this is a fixation which is the best that we could do. The head does go into AVN, and in 2009 post-op, 2 years, he had a reasonable function. But 8 years down the line, he had AVN and the screw started penetrating and got pain. He's now 75. So we decided to, because the shoulder function was not good, a replacement was done. 3 years after that, he fractures this. And then we had to do a reconstruction of that. We'd add on strut graft as well as add on plates. And that's 1 year down the line. He had a decent functional arm. So remember, there is a scapular notching also, which is a problem of the reverse shoulder. What about the role of an intermedullary nail in a 3- and 4-part humerus fractures? These are minimally invasive. Lex is invasive dissection. They have a shorter lever arm. The current one set of nails that are there provide a medial support and a calcar support. They have multiple modular locked option. I must say, in my practice so far, I've just decided to use it in 2 and 3 parts only. I'll show you a 2-part case that I did. The varus collapse, this is the key. Everybody is trying to prevent the varus collapse and providing you with a stability screw, the kickstand screw, whether it is a plate or a nail. This is a 2-part fracture. So I started off with simple fractures, and they recommend you could use it in a 3- and 4-part. You have the calcar screws to support that for fixation as well. So these are the various options in a nail that is available. The results with nail, the model implants that are available will prevent the screw back out, which was a problem of the earlier nails. The current multi-lock system has found that the backing out was not as much, but there are still cases of backing out. What about when you compare nail versus plate? In the 2- and 3-part, nails seem to be better, doing better. In the 4-part, plates seem to be doing better. That is, and the functional results are overall similar in both the groups. What about arthroplasty versus non-operative? Now, these, to my mind, are two separate group of patients that you need to address. In the arthroplasty versus non-operative, the outcomes, pain-wise, is better in the arthroplasty group versus the non-operative group. There is still a certain group of patients where I would still go for a non-operative treatment. However, if they are in pain, then arthroplasty would be a reasonable option. So my take-home message, friends, is these are fractures mainly in the elderly. In the young, you have to go ahead and fix. Like in any other intra-articular fractures, you need to kind of get a proper evaluation and careful planning. I would recommend, make sure that varus you need to correct in all, whether you're doing an IM nailing or a plate fixation. Make sure that you get that stability properly. Remember, the car sign and the floor of the car has to be in the direction that I mentioned. Between an arthroplasty and a 4-part, and when I say arthroplasty, I include hemi versus reverse shoulder, the superiority is yet to be proven. But when you do choose to fix it, make sure your surgical principles are sound, and the 6 steps I shared with you should help you in getting a low complication rate. Thank you very much.
Excellent, Vivek. Can you stop sharing your screen? Probably what I can conclude from your talk, you have stressed on two important things, is we do not want a varus,
Vivek sir, stop sharing first.
Yes. Sorry.
So you have enumerated all the important points and the steps what are required for getting a good reduction and fixation. And yes. Your conclusion is like, we do not want varus at any cost. And second, most important is your reduction and reduction, right? Yes. Whether you use a plate or you choose a minimal invasive fixation, like what Dr. Gadigone is doing, like minimal invasive flower technique or J technique, or even if you use a nail, in all, correcting the varus is the key thing. And second is the reduction. And I have questions to all the faculty in relation to that. Now, how do you ensure or how do you confirm that your fracture reduction is not in varus? I am not asking about the technique. How do you ensure on the operating table that you are not giving a varus to the reduction? I am not discussing the technique. Only how will you confirm that? And please don't repeat what you have said or what others have said. Asim, yes.
For the sentence line, that contour on the medial side has to be perfect. My greater tuberosity has to sit in a place where top of the greater tuberosity is about 8 mm from the highest point of the articular surface of the head. That relationship has to be perfect. And in both AP and the sagittal, especially the sagittal view, the shaft should sit in line with the head. So, all these 3-4 things are being fulfilled. Then I pass my guide wire only, not the issue.
I'm not asking the technique. How do you confirm? That is all.
Yeah, if the calcar screw is going in the right place, then...
That is different. Before that, before we plate, how do you ensure your reduction is not in varus? Chetan, anything you want to add?
Yeah, so once I get the reduction, I would temporarily fix with multiple K wires. One
so that is about the reduction part, Chetan.
Oh, after how do that, you ensure,
no, yeah. No. How do you ensure you have achieved a normal position on a C arm? What are the points which you look for so that you don't ensure that you have ended up in a varus?
Yes.
I'll just say. One is what Dr. Vivek has said, the ambassador sign. Second, what Asim has said, your greater tuberosity should be about a centimeter below the highest point of the humeral head. Third is the gothic arch, that is the lateral border of the scapula and the medial border of the humeral head. And the shaft should have, you should look for a gothic sign. And third is what he says is the plate should be in the center, in the lateral view also, in the humeral head and the shaft. Anything else?
Yes, you calculate the CCD angle on the C-arm. Okay. So the neck shaft, accept it less than 120 degrees. So right. 120 is your limit. If it is not 120, you correct it above 120. And so, in the that the head is aligned, as well as lateral, there in AP there should not be, the angle should not be less than 120, and in lateral there should be no angulation up to 30 degrees is acceptable as per literature, but try and get it as centralized as possible.
Mohan, anything you want to add?
No, I think everything has been said. I think
okay.
Sangeet, yeah. There was one of the images, there was a goniometer that was kept on the C-arm image. So if you have a goniometer and those lines anywhere up to 130, try and get up to 130. So that is a very easy way to kind of look at your reduction.
Okay. So these are the 5-6 points which are important when you see your reduction on a C-arm, and try to get that to avoid a varus. Now, having got that, how do you maintain the reduction? It is often seen that you get that, all these things, you get a normal position, but somewhere while transfixing the fracture with the K wires, that reduction is not maintained. While plating, your reduction is lost. So how do you avoid that? Mohan, can you start?
Yeah, I think as these people have said, either fix it with the K-wire or take the sutures in, I would also take a suture in the head also. I don't do much fixation nowadays, but take suture in the head part of it and then hold it as a hat on hook sort of a thing. And you may even tie it to the shaft temporarily so as to maintain that valgus position.
Chetan?
Yeah, so there are two ways to maintain that reduction. One is multiple K wires, as has been said, not just one. Second, you can use a strut graft intramedullary, or sometimes some surgeons have even used an intramedullary plate, a 1/3 tubular plate to keep that. Third method is to use bone substitutes or allografts to jack up the height of the humeral head and maintain your valgus. And fourth or a last desperate resort would be to transfix it to the glenoid with the K wire.
Okay, okay.
And then build up your metaphysis over it.
Yeah, Vivek, so, anything to add?
So another important thing is you tie the subscapularis and the supraspinatus to each other. So that kind of like a egg holder crushes the keeps the head up and kind of strangulates the head so that it doesn't fall in. So that step also
control of the head. You have the control of the head
from sinking down. Invariably, what happens is once the suture is taken, there is a tendency to pass the suture to the plate and then tie it. Mm. I think you should tie it to each other. Then it kind of makes sure that it sits flush. Then you won't lose the reduction. And then one point that I said, the first hole, you should not automatically think non-lock. Then you will pull the diaphysis towards the plate and then make it again unhinge the medial side. So you need to remember that as well.
That is a plate reduction. Aseem, anything else you want to add? What you were saying last, the K-wire.
K-wire, my presentation has got a slide. When we are passing the K-wire from top, we tend to push the shaft medially and we lose the reduction. So you put a spike there. It will come in the slide presentation there. There is a spike which prevents loss of reduction. Right. And maintains Shenton's line and Gothika.
And the last question to the master of the master class, Dr. Vasudev Gadigone. About both the points, can you sum up?
First point, that is how to maintain the reduction, that assess the reduction, everything is covered. For maintenance of the reduction, I put sometimes 4 KY, 2 from below and 2 from above. And not only in the same plane, but it is in the different plane that will not come in the way of our plate. So that gives you the better idea where the yes. But there is a one question to ask Gawale sir.
So you mean to say, let me complete. Huh. When you pass the K wires in the humeral head, they should fan in the different quadrant. They should not converge. Otherwise, you will lose the loss of reduction.
Is possible in osteoporotic.
Right. Yes, sir. Your question.
Another question I want to ask, how to assess rotational malalignment of the head during the C-arm position?
When you have done an open reduction, it is your bicipital groove which gives you orientation of the reduction and the rotation part, what you are discussing. Vivek, anything else you check for?
So I want that plate sitting perfectly in the center on the lateral view of a true lateral. As long as that is bang in the center, then a slight mal rotation, I don't think it's a little forgiving. So I think we should be reasonably okay. So, and just to add a point, Sangeet, is even when you are passing the K-wire, I just normally put a plate where I want to be. And then I pass the wire from posterior, from the skin, missing the plate and into the head from different direction, from front and back. So I have the plate in place so that I don't pass the wire first, because otherwise it comes in the way when your plate wants to come there. So as a plate, as a template, and the wire from posterior through the skin and anterior, that is sometimes I use as well as an option.
Right. Vivek has made a very good conclusion. Like your proximal humerus locking plate is a plate which has to be fixed in an anatomical position. It is not going to sit properly in a non-anatomical position. That means if you have a mal reduction, your plate is not going to sit. That means your proximal screws, they will not go in a desired direction in the head. So that is a very key thing. Whenever you are putting a plate, it has to be in that position, 1 centimeter lateral to the bicipital groove. And in a lateral view, it should be in the center of the head and the center of the shaft to ensure you have not malreduced it either in varus or valgus or in rotation.
So right. One point to, again, I want to make it clear. Vivek sir, what is the preference of your the first screw, A, B, C, D, E? Which screw you want to put first?
Sir, in that situation, if I am using a direct lateral approach in a three-part fracture, then my D or is a screw which I use because the axillary nerve comes bang there. If I am using a deltopectoral approach, I use the E screw to help me place that. Now, there are some ladies, Indian ladies, whose head is very small. If that is the case, then I use the D screw to get my calcar screw in. I need to make sure that my plate doesn't go beyond the 8 millimeter mark. Otherwise, the impingement is an issue. So my first screw is the calcar screw, at least the guide wire to help me locate that placement of that kickstand screw that I showed. That is where I start.
And the other reason why that calcar screw should go first is if it is going in the inferior quadrant, you probably know that you are not ending up in varus.
Correct.
Otherwise, if it is in varus, it will go in the center of the head.
Correct.
But
at the plate time, the plate positioning and screw time is not the time to know that you are in varus.
Right.
You should have double checked and three times. Yeah. It is too late by then. Yes.
Chetan.
I have a question to Vivek.
Yeah.
In what osteoporosis you have, and then women never goes in. If you have your phylos placed.
Chetan.
I don't know whether it is me. The question is, guys, I'm coming staggered. Is it
Chetan,
me or?
You stop your video. Stop your video. Your audio is interrupting. And Asim, can you share your screen for your next presentation?
Yeah.
Yeah, Chetan.
Yeah, please.
No, sometimes when you have metafascial comminution and in porotic, small heads, this is that the E screw goes below the head and not into the head. How do you deal with that then?
Play.
So the E screw is going out of the head, you are saying?
Yeah, below the head. It does
Correct.
Not really go perfectly in the calcar. The
Correct.
D goes, but the E doesn't.
So then if what... there is a medial comminution, you are asking, Chetan?
Yes, yes.
So in those cases, I'm lucky enough that we have that strut graft. So when that happens, I add that strut and then put the E screw through the strut onto the other side to hold the strut in the medial, near the medial inferior angle. So I use the D screw as my calcar screw then. I know there are people who would use a plate also inside, as you mentioned, but I would use a reinforcing strut graft there so that the comminution is protected.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah,
thank you. Asim, can you play?
I'm going to talk about mainly isolated GT fractures. Isolated greater tuberosity fractures, they are seen more often in young patients, male more than the female, and they occur because of the high velocity in UV.
Can you switch to a play mode?
Pardon?
Can you switch to the play mode?
It's not.
No.
Full screen.
No, at our end, it is not seen.
Excuse me, sir, you can just click on from beginning.
I stop share and come back again.
Asim, you just click on that down this thing symbol of the full screen. You don't have to play it again. There is a small symbol on the right down bottom down there. So you can just click on that full screen symbol.
I'm not seeing any.
Okay, share your screen first.
It's full screen, so I'm not able to come out of the full screen.
You can press escape.
Escape. Just...
Sangeet, you can share now.
Yeah, Sangeet, you can share. Just.
This one.
Yeah. This one.
This one.
Greater tuberosity.
Yeah. No? Same one. Yeah.
Same presentation.
You are sharing, Sangeet?
Yeah, I am. It is with me.
Okay. Then we start with this. Yeah, make it full screen.
Is it now visible to you?
Yeah, it's visible to me. And it's full screen.
Okay. Yeah. Start, please.
I start. Yeah. The greater tuberosity fractures. Next. Yeah. Are seen in young patients, males more than the female, and they occur as a result of high velocity injury usually. They account for about 20% of the proximal humeral fractures, and half of them are associated with dislocations. The good news is that 90% of them can be treated conservatively. Next. In a series of 38 patients with isolated fracture greater tuberosity, Vardhana concluded that patient with posterior superior displacement had worse outcome than anterior superior or anterior inferior displacement. Here, the supraspinatus is responsible for the superior displacement, while supraspinatus is mainly responsible for the posterior displacement. And this posterior displacement is often underestimated. Surgeon must bother to take both the AP and the accelerated lateral view of such injuries. Next. Next, yeah. When I treat them conservatively, I immobilize them in abduction and axial rotation for about a month. Weekly x-rays are taken to look for any secondary displacement. MRI is usually asked for at 2 months or 3 months if there is excessive pain or there is loss of function. But in today's practice, most patients walk in my clinic with MRI in their hands. The 60-year-old patients with a greater tuberosity fracture and comorbidities, diabetic, asthmatic, hypertensive, CAD, was treated conservatively. And 8 weeks down the line, the fracture has beautifully healed with excellent return of function. Next. That's dysfunction in 2 months. When you are treating these fractures conservatively, you should be aware of any late displacement. You can't just sleep over it. Remember that 60% of these fractures which are initially minimally displaced, further displaced at follow-up. Higher risk patients for further displacement are young patients and males. In a series of 55 patients of fractured GT with anterior dislocation, 20% had late GT migration. And this risk is 6 times more in patients younger than 70 years old. Next. CT is extremely important to find out any comminution of the fragment, action and the amount of displacement. And remember that 10% of the isolated so-called GT fractures have associated undisplaced fracture neck femur, which can have grave consequences for the treatment. 60% of the fractured GT involves supra as well as infraspinatus both, leading to superior and posterior displacement. Next. The book indication for MRI is persistent pain, limited range of motion after conservative treatment. 20% of these patients with GT fracture have foot thickness tear at 1 year follow and is important to detect rotator cuff atrophy in late cases, which helps the surgeon to decide whether you can go for a cuff reconstruction or you have to choose RSA or some other form of treatment. MRI is less useful in fresh cases because of the extensive trauma causing post-traumatic edema. Next. Ultrasonography is wonderful, is cheap, easily available, is a dynamic real-time study, excellent to diagnose discontinuity of the cuff in fresh cases, good to detect atrophy in late cases, but is heavily operator dependent and there are not many sonographers who are trained to do the musculoskeletal things. Next. This is a new classification published in JBJS 2014, a series of 199 patients, which helps to guide the technique of surgical treatment of these fractures. 40% were avulsion type fractures, 20% were depression type, and 40% were split type. NIRS and AO classification, which are based on fragment displacement, have poor inter and intra-observer reliability and do not give any treatment guidelines. Next. Kavachan type fracture count for 40% of the GT fractures. Small fragment, horizontal fracture line, as you can see there, 20% of them will need surgery. They should be treated like rotator cuff tears by a double row suture anchor technique or transosseous suture techniques. Suture anchors, they are expensive, but they provide a stable interface, early vascularization, and restore normal rotator cuff function in most patients if done properly. Next. In another study, it was found that DRSA construct offers superior performance during abduction exercises vis-a-vis screw fixation. Next. This 55-year-old male had a fall, diabetic, hypertensive, comminuted GT. As you can see, there are two parts. Next. Was treated by split deltoid. Sutures were taken in the supraspinatus and infraspinatus. Temporary fixation with K-wires. The fiber wire sutures were passed through the holes in the plate and the whole comminuted GT was buttressed nicely. Next. You can see that immediate post-op X-ray looks beautiful, but at 4 months, patient had pain, poor shoulder function because the GT has avulsed proximal to the plate. 7 months, both the times I offered him surgery, but he succumbed to surgery only at 8 months. Next, when plate was removed, cuff was mobilized, crater was freshened, and next, we used a double row suture anchor technique to fix it, and patient had excellent recovery function. Next. That's his function, and you can see the video there on the right side. Sangeet, can you play the video? Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah. In spite of his age and diabetes and other problems, he is fully recovered. Next. For Avulsion type of fracture GT, you can use transosseous technique in constrained setups. It's cheap. Multiple non-resorbable sutures are passed through rotator cuff with a bony bridge of 1 centimeter at least. But this technique tends to fail in osteopenic bones and has poor rotational stability. Next, this is how you go about it. Multiple transosseous sutures through tunnels. Next, this is one of the patients, intra-op pictures. Next, depression type of fracture GT happens in about 20% of all isolated GT fractures, involves an inferiorly displaced impacted GT as shown in the middle picture there, generally occurs after anterior dislocation. 7% of these fractures may require surgery. Next. One of these patients, obese, female, uncontrolled, non-compliant, diabetic, we treated conservatively, but at 10 months, she ended up with this. COVID also played a role in delaying the surgery. Next. At 10 months, we did an open reduction, used suture anchors, double row suture anchor technique, and we expect her to get a normal recovery. It was done only 1 year, 1 month back, so I don't have the function. Next. Split type. They count for 40% of all isolated GT fractures. There is a large fragment with a vertical fracture line. 30% of them may require surgery. Fixation, my arthroscopic colleagues will prefer a DRSA while a trauma surgeon will always choose augmentation sutures and thin 3.5 LCPs. They are the best. Do not try to use screws alone because post-op fragmentation can occur. Fragment can get displaced, leading to rotator cuff deficiency. Next. How do you reduce the isolated GT fracture? The preferred approach should always be a split deltoid for this. And you should use anterior fracture line for reduction, not the posterior fracture line, which is often comminuted and impacted. If you do a posterior mal reduction, there is decreased external rotation and weakening of the posterior rotator cuff. How do you recognize that you have reduced properly anteriorly? Next. Picture on the left-hand side shows that anterior fracture line has not been properly reduced and gap has not closed. So the rotator cuff interval doesn't close, and you can see the articular surface of the head. If you reduce the anterior fracture line properly, the rotator interval automatically closes and you can't see the articular surface of the humeral head. So that's the correct way of reducing it. Next. Next important aspect is superior aspect of the GT lies about 5 to 8 millimeter distal to most superior aspect of the head. Next. temporary fixation. Sangeet, next. Temporary fixation is done with the help of K wires having achieved proper height of the GT, and sutures, fiber wire or Ethibond, they are taken through supraspinatus and infraspinatus. You can pass these sutures through holes in the plate and buttress it with a thin 3.5 LCP. Next. In this patient, we have used a first generation very thin Philos plate made by an Indian company, which is not really bulky and covered the whole comminuted greater trochanter, greater tuberosity, and patient had an excellent function at 2 years. Next. This patient is our pathologist, fracture GT treated by a split deltoid. Here we fixed it with a distal radius locking plate and went on to heal with good recovery of function. Next. 50-year-old female. Here the surgeon forgot to take the lateral view. There is a thin, flimsy shadow beneath the acromion, which you can see there, where the cuff was avulsed. Next. At 4 months down the line, patient had pain, loss of abduction, was open reduced with, and fixed with tension band. This was done almost 15 to 20 years back. I won't use this type of tension band wiring today. Next. That's the function. Next. This is the treatment algorithm for fracture GT. Basically, this busy slide tells you that if there is a displacement of more than 5 mm, then smaller fragments you treat by suture anchors, transosseous, or the DRSA technique. Larger fragments you use buttress plate in heavy manual workers and overhead in the athletes who need overhead action. A displacement of more than 3 mm will warrant fixation. You can choose to treat these patients conservatively if patient is unwilling or he's not fit. Till the time function is not good and you have to convert them to a surgery. Next. Next. I think that's the last slide. Can we go to the split deltoid, Sangeet? Friends, last 3 to 4 years, I've been treating 3 and 4 parts fractures of the upper end of the humerus by split deltoid approach, and believe me that I am a convert. It's fun doing this approach. Next, this 3-part fracture of the upper end of the humerus in a 45-year female, diabetic, obese, was treated by split deltoid. Next, I prefer to get my C-arm from the opposite side. You can operate these patients in the supine or full beach chair position, but full beach chair means you need GA. I use brachial block and a semi-beach chair position, get my C-arm from the opposite side. Next. Patient is supine, 30-40 degree head and elevated, semi-beach. Check X-ray visibility before you even drape the patient and mark the position of the C-arm for intra-op use. The skin incision is from the anterolateral corner of the acromion and extends down towards the lateral epicondyle of humerus. Next. Once you expose the deltoid, you can see a thin white avascular raphe between anterior third of deltoid and third, which you can open with finger dissection or blunt dissection. It will automatically open up there. Next. Then you incise the subdeltoid bursa in the proximal window as we are doing it here. And then you start looking for next. Axillary now is about 6.5 centimeters from the lateral margin of the acromion. It's a tight rod-like structure. It's the only structure which is traversing horizontally from posterior to anterior. Rest of the things, they are going from superior to towards the elbow. Books say that you should put a loop, but I do not put a loop around it. I just have a look at it, feel for it. Next. And then I dissect the shaft distal to the axillary nerve. Next. The commonest error while expanding the approach distal is to go posterior to humerus shaft, which I made in first 1 or 2 cases. you should extend your incision towards the lateral epicondyle, and you can feel the anterior and the posterior border of the humeral shaft with blunt KVAX, and then expose the area between these two margins, protecting the axillary nerve. Next. Then you use a blunt periosteum to make a nice good tunnel beneath the axillary nerve. Axillary nerve and vessels, they cross horizontally, and you should make enough space for there to bulk, for bulky villus to be passed. Next. You incise bursa to expose the fracture of the greater tuberosity, and then you can open it like a book and start working from within the fracture in the metaphyseal area. Next. Then I use 5-number Ethibond or fiber wire to fix first supraspinatus. The second suture is next. Posteriorly in the infraspinatus, sometimes another suture in the teres minor, and the last suture I take is the next subscapularis. And I pull on these sutures to maneuver my reduction, final reduction. I use a blunt periosteum from within the fracture site in the hollow there to reduce the head. If it's in valgus, I push it. If it's in varus, I try to lift the head through a blunt periosteum. I pull on the tuberosities to improve my reduction, and I maneuver the shaft fragment by holding the arm of the patient, adducting or abducting the arm as the need be, and check radiologically that whether reduction is improving or not. A K-wire has been passed in the greater tuberosity from drop through the supraspinatus, and that also can be used as a joystick to assist reduction by maneuvering the greater tuberosity. Next. This is how the reduction steps go on. Next. Temporary fixation is done by K-wires, which are placed such that they don't interfere with my final plate position. Next. Having reduced the fracture, pass fibrosity sutures through the holes in the plate, and then you slide in your LCP deep to the axillary nerve. Adjust the plate head 8 millimeter below superior surface of head, as Dr. Vivek also said, and mark its position. Next. You must restore this chental line and the gothic arc, which Sangeet was talking about, the border of the scapula and the medial border of the humerus. This gothic arc should be in continuity. My spike on the medial side of the shaft there is preventing this loss of reduction. When you try to build the K wires from superior to medial side distally, the wires, they tend to push the shaft and you tend to lose the reduction. So this thin spike is giving counter force to that thing, and the chental line is maintained. Next. Then I try to pass one or two screws in the superior fragment, and then I pass, first screw is usually a cortical reduction screw passed in the oblong hole there. This you can use as a push or pull screw, as Dr. Vivek also mentioned. If you are using it as a pull screw, then shaft is usually on the medial side, and when you tighten this screw, it pulls the shaft laterally. This step has to be done under image intensifier guidance. Do not overcorrect, otherwise you will lose the gothic arc. Next. And having passed this first screw, you should check the alignment and plate position on the lateral view. Do not accept what is seen on the left. You can still, you have not burnt your bridges. You just tighten this, loosen this screw. The screw is in the oblong hole, so you can distract fracture by a few millimeters. The spike is pushing the shaft to its correct position. And on the right side, you can see that the perfect reduction has been achieved and plate is centrally placed. Next. That's my final suture construct. Next. Next. 3 months. Next. 7 months. Next. That's her function. Next. 9 months. Next. There is a video there. The fracture has healed. She can do all her heavy manual work, though she is a diabetic, obese, hypertensive. And 54, 55. I give them a sling. Passive range of motion is taught to the relatives, which they are supposed to do 3 times a day for about 4 to 6 weeks. Active range of motion starts around 6 weeks, initially active assisted, then active by 3 months. They are ready to do the strength exercises in the 4th month, and the function goes on improving for a year. Next. This split deltoid has many advantages. It minimizes the soft tissue dissection. I don't have to release the deltoid insertion, which is a worry for me when doing the deltopectoral. I don't have to really retract deltoid heavily to catch hold of GT. This is a direct approach to lateral plating zone of the humerus. Humeral head blood supply doesn't enter the surgical field directly, and reduction maneuvers, they are all performed from within the fracture lines. So no periosteal disturbance. Next. Everything comes with a price. Most orthopods are not familiar with this surface, with this approach. We are afraid to handle the X-ray now for fear of palsy. It's difficult to convert to arthroplasty intraoperative. Next. In contrast, deltopectoral has the advantage of being a familiar approach to all of us, is extensile, and you can easily convert to replacement. However, there are disadvantages. You have to really release the insertion of deltoid significantly. If you have to catch GT, then you have to really retract hard, which may be difficult in an obese patient, and risk of devascularizing the fragments is always there because blood vessels are area, and slightly increased risk of AVN and non-union because of all these problems. Next. Thank you very much, Ashim.
Nice presentation, Ashim.
Thank you, sir.
And Sangeet ji, you lead the discussion so that we can clear some of the ideas of fibrotic surgery.
Yeah. My question is to all the faculty. Many a times in these late follow-ups, you see invagination or atrophy of the muscles. Any reason for that, Vivek? Okay, oh, Chetan?
Whenever you see this, it is quite expected because the muscle, especially the deltoid and the rotator, is both inhibited. So what I is also advocated, we immediately start the pendular exercises, the elbow range of motion fully, intermittently in with a sling. And I also do not hesitate to electrically stimulate the deltoid and the supraspinatus, infraspinatus, as a routine. So the patient goes for supervised physical therapy, or the physiotherapist goes to the patient's house. Now it's very easily available everywhere, and teaches him how to electrically stimulate that intermittently throughout the day. And that, really reduces that atrophy or the slight subluxation of the humeral head, which we see in post-op X-rays.
Mohan.
Disease atrophy is reversible. The fatty infiltration is not. So disease atrophy is common because many times...
Mohan, understand my question. It is only the anterior third of the deltoid, not the complete deltoid. So there is an invagination and there is a significant atrophy of only that part of the deltoid, not the complete deltoid.
Okay.
I was thinking about the rotator cuff. Around when you take a deltopectoral incision.
Okay.
Like the medial side looks okay. The pectoral side looks okay. But the deltoid side, there is an invagination. Does that represent the trauma to the anterior division of the axillary nerve? That is what I'm asking.
Yeah, I think it may be because of the denervation, but I would like to. It may be because of the denervation of the nerve to that portion of the muscle. That is what I feel. But I would like to have other faculty's opinion as well.
Okay, Vivek.
Sangeet, that may be transient neuropraxia of the...
No, sir. Late. Six months, 1 year. I'm up. Vivek, anything?
I don't have anything to say on this. I must say I'm not noticed. So you have kind of sharp clinical eyes to notice that. So no, I've not noticed that.
Yeah, Asim.
Sandeep, there are studies on this. There are two papers. We did EMG and nerve conduction of consecutive patients, say 50 patients at the center, and both with the deltopectoral as well as the split deltoid, EMG and nerve conduction proven involvement of nerve was seen in more than 80%. But the good news was that by 6 to 9 months, 90% had recovered. So we don't have to be really afraid of seeing the now. Initially, it is there. Both the papers concluded, it recovers.
Coming back to your...
unless you cut it.
Yeah. Coming back to your question, a question on greater tuberosity. You said you look for only the anterior reduction. Many a time what happens is posteriorly it is covered by the rotator cuff. So we really don't see the fracture line. And post-operatively or on the C-arm images, it appears like in one view, it appears to have well reduced, but in the other view, there is a significant gap. So how do you handle that posterior part reduction of the greater tuberosity?
Posterior part has often comminution and cancellous bone will heal with compression. So if you are anteriorly matched the cortical reduction well, even if there is some compression achieved, it will not weaken the cuff. But if you reduce posteriorly and leave it anteriorly, you will have a deficient external rotation and weakening. So if you overcompress, it may be slightly tight initially, but muscles will stretch.
Right.
Reduce anteriorly, that is the non-comminuted line.
Excellent. And second thing you said, many a times there is a large greater tuberosity fragment. And at least on three or four occasions, when I interacted with different surgeons, they thought it is a split head and they converted to a hemi replacement. Any views on that? You know, their perception is that greater tuberosity is a large fragment and that appears on a CT image or a plain X-ray as a head split. And that is a reason in those borderline age group, they converted to a hemi replacement.
Split head is not an indication for arthroplasty for a trauma set.
Yeah. Chetan, your views on that?
I've seen that being done.
Unmute yourself.
So I would not suddenly rush onto a hemi. I would think that I'll keep hemi as a backup, maybe if I see that on a CT scan. But I would make all the attempts to fix it. I have even fixed split heads with Herbert screws and re-implanted that head back on the shaft. And, you know, it has done pretty well, especially in young patients with good bone stock.
Sangeet, if I may... When you have this, the question where once you fix the GT fragment, posteriorly it kind of lifts off. I mean, I've kind of struggled with this frustrating fracture and I have put in a 1/3 tubular plate like a necklace going from front and back to kind of grab it like a half circle. So this is one area which is asking for a new plate design for a GT, which has something like a hook which pushes down. And then a semicircle which goes and grabs it, which goes down the shaft. So it's a plate. There's a plate waiting to happen there. And I'm pretty sure if somebody...
Sir, one patient where there is an Indian company's first generation Philos is exactly like that. It's pretty broad, very thin, and it allows you to pass screws all around over a broader area, which fits perfectly over that area of bone.
Asim ji, what do you think of that plate? I mean, is that something...
It is on local made, Baroda and Ahmedabad. And...
No. Okay.
Vivek, the plate what you're talking is already there. There is some guy from Colombia or Portugal who has been using that and he has presented like it is an extension of the proximal humerus plate.
Correct.
So to take care of those comminuted greater trochanter, which has an extension posteriorly.
Correct.
So this can take care of that.
So but proximally, is there a hook to push it down?
There were 2-3 designs, but the main what was appealing is it has a larger extension than the normal plate to capture the part of the greater tuberosity.
Correct.
Asim, last question to you.
Yes, sir.
See, the most important screws are those calcar screws. And they come exactly where your the axillary nerve winds around the humerus. So how much is a good retraction of that axillary nerve when you're passing the screws in that zone?
I do it with a mosquito. I tighten my sleeve
and leave the mosquito. The sleeve protects the drilling and other part, and that particular screw, I don't use power to shoot it.
And any advantage of
it's taking... fairly mobile. That axillary now is fairly mobile.
So that problems comes when you're taking two separate incisions.
No.
And leaving that intervening skin intact.
What do you achieve by saving those two stitches? It's crazy. It's crazy. Absolutely crazy. And anybody who wants to do three-part and four-part, he should start with a simple greater tuberosity fracture to have a feel of the thing. And initially, you can call one of those scopy surgeons, arthroscopy, sports medicine guys also. So if two of you are there, then after two or three cases, you'll be bindas. You don't need, they are better equipped to handle the rotator cuff and other things. So first one or two cases, you can seek some help from those guys.
Sangeet, one last question from me to Ashim. Suppose you feel 3 weeks old fracture, greater tuberosity, depression. But if you see after 3 weeks, there is no bone in chain and you are pretty sure that it is a supraspinatus avulsion injury. In a such a situation, how will you handle this thing? Because you want to do a surgery. So there is no bone left there because it is not visible at least on the X-ray. So how do you go away?
Sir, there was a patient at 10 months. You hardly see any bone in the greater tuberosity. She is obese. She is diabetic. But when we opened it, there was enough cancellous bone there. And we could take anchor sutures. We have done that about a month back. And she's doing extremely well. Pain has gone away. She can do abduction, but we are not allowing her, protecting her because of her obesity, diabetes, and it's only 4 weeks. So you may not see it on the X-ray, but on table, there is enough cancellous bone to use suture anchors. And I won't use plate or screws for that situation. It will always be suture anchors. And Indian suture anchors are not very expensive. Good ones are available now.
Chetan, can you share your screen? Meanwhile, Mohan, you have a question. Mohan?
Yes, yes, I had a question for Dr. Asim. Same question
yes, that
Dr. Gadegone asked. I am not asking about depressed fracture, but displaced or malunited GT, which has gone really posteriorly and superiorly. How easy it is to reconstruct that and get back to its original position?
I have done up to almost 6 months, Mohan sir. And it's not easy, but you can have patience and go on mobilizing. And then after that also, you have to splint them in abduction and external rotation and gently bring them to neutral. If you try to keep them arm side of the chest, then probably your fixation will give way. So initially, give little abduction and external rotation and first 3-4 weeks, you protect whatever you have achieved on the table. And it works in a young patient.
Ashim, last question. Do you advocate acrobioplasty in such a situation? Because whatever the malunited fragments, however you reconstructed them, they are going to be some mal reduction of the greater tuberosity unless you find a very good crater. So in that case, do you advise acrobioplasty to get a better movements?
That's an intra-op decision, sir.
Have you done it before?
No. Not.
Sangeet, what is your opinion?
No, sir. Primarily because in a fresh case or a old case?
Old cases.
Because already the humerus head is subluxated because of the rotator cuff injury. And there is enough space.
Yeah.
So we cannot make out really whether a patient has an impingement or an issue on the table.
Okay.
Right. So Chetan is going to speak on something different which we haven't heard about, anterior fracture dislocation of shoulder. Chetan, please.
Yes. So we are now into the realm of dislocations. And if you see the anterior dislocation along with the fractures of the proximal humerus, the more commoner variety is the tuberosity fracture, which is associated with anterior fracture dislocation. So all of us have dealt with it very, very commonly to the tune of about 30%. Whereas a rare entity, which is also not very uncommon, but rather rare, is an anterior dislocation of the head with a proximal fractures of the humerus, which is to the tune of only 2% in most of the proximal humerus fractures. So let's see both of these and how do we handle these. So the commoner version is the fracture of the GT. We have been conventionally taught right from residency days that you just reduce the shoulder and the GT will fall back in place, and that is all that is required. So then should we fix the GT fragment? If at all, what is the best way to fix it? We have seen a part of the previous presentation how to fix it and what happens if you don't fix it after you reduce your dislocation. So if you don't fix that greater tuberosity fragment, you're likely to get impingement on abduction. Sometimes the non-unions, as just asked and discussed, can be painful with restricted abduction and internal rotation. Rotator function, rotator dysfunction is definitely seen. A deltoid and a trapeze, which is rather painful in overhead activities. So that is the reason why we should be very vigilant about these fractures and actually manage them surgically. The problem is that you don't see them well on x-rays because most of the post-reduction x-rays taken in the casualty or later on are in adduction and internal rotation, which do not show the displacement or the size of the fracture or the tuberosity clearly, unless they are taken in full external rotation, which you cannot do because the shoulder might redislocate or subluxate. So the better option is to do a CT scan for two reasons. One is to evaluate the size and displacement of the fracture, the fragment, and to diagnose associated neck fractures. You might be surprised that on the CT you see undisplaced cracked necks or sometimes even frankly displaced neck fractures. So if you see this, this is a post-reduction view taken in the casualty, and this does not show the size or the displacement of the fragment. Whereas if you take it in maximum external rotation, you see that fragment clearly, and the CT definitely shows it in a better manner. Now, across the literature, there's no consensus on when to fix this and even how to fix it. Some say more than 10 mm or more than 5 mm or more than 3 mm. But then if you see all the recent literature, up to 5 mm can be conserved. 5 to 10 mm in young patients must be fixed, and more than 10 mm displacement definitely should be operated upon. I'm talking about the displacement and not the size of the fragment. So for those tuberosity fragments, there are three methods: percutaneous screw fixations, open fixations already discussed, and arthroscopy assisted. Percutaneous, I would not really recommend because the tuberosity is rather posterior, and this is what happened to one of our patients. This looked good on a Siam image, but did not look so well in the post-op x-ray because you could see a flake there, infrascapular in infraspinous. And when the lateral axial view was taken, the tuberosity was far more behind than what was thought, and it had missed. Also, you must keep the screw short in the head because over a period of time, the metafascia, the compact bone may resorb and the screw becomes prominent. So to fix them, both beach chair as well as supine position, both deltopectoral as well as the split approach can be utilized. For pure tuberosities, I prefer the deltoid split. I'm not familiar with doing the deltoid split for platings, for proximal humeral fractures, but for tuberosity fractures, I would use the deltoid split. We just saw it in action, but it gives you an excellent access to the tuberosity fragments, even if they are comminuted. And then you can fix them using either transosseous sutures or suture anchors or cannulated screws, using screws as a post, or if it is too badly comminuted, then even a plate can be used. So rotator cuff, sutures across the rotator cuff to align and enhance the stability are a must. And so this is how you do it. You can use anchors and sutures across the rotator cuff. You should not do over reduction because that will cause crushing of the fragment and thinning out of the rotator cuff and subsequent dysfunction. So this can get resorbed, and then the rotator does not, cuff does not function. So these are all the options which you can use to fix these fractures. A better method is to pass anchors through the crater, then reduce the fragment over it like this. This is what I usually use, and then take the suture across the fiber wire across the rotator cuff. And this heals pretty well. This is a new hybrid technique described where you use screws along with the anchor like this. There is even a plate mentioned in literature, the Bamberg plate, which is a low profile plate for very comminuted tuberosity fragments. And that can give a good buttress action over the comminuted tuberosity. The scopists usually use the Arthrex speed bridge technique across the rotator cuff, and this provides excellent fixation of those fragments, especially when they're small or in old cases where you cannot find adequate size of the fragments. This is these are a few of my cases. 31 years old, reduction of the dislocation in the casualty. It does appear to fall back, but if you take the CT scan, it's displaced and quite a big fragment. So fixed with standard Velos, the tuberosity sutured to the plate with number 5 Ethibond. This is at 6 weeks, and this is the function at 6 months. Another fracture, anterior dislocation with tuberosity fracture. Close reduction shows good alignment of the tuberosity. CT does not show, say so. So you have to fix it. This is fixed again with Velos and healed well. Next we come to rare, but nowadays commonly seen, the fracture dislocations of the proximal humerus. Robinson classified them into two types. Type 1 was where there was a fracture dislocation and the head had a retained capsular attachment with a medial hinge of more than 2 centimeters. Now, these are usually seen in younger patients, and here the head remains pretty viable. Whereas type 2 are seen in older patients where there is no capsular attachment or a medial hinge is less than 2 centimeters. This is the head at risk of AVN. So these are the two standard types described by Robinson. What are the problems that we are looking at? One, we do not know about the viability of the humeral head. There is an associated capsular labral injury because the head has sometimes torn the labrum and lying anteriorly. The reduction may be difficult, especially as days pass by. The head may be very porotic, so your fixation may be difficult. There may be associated glenoid fractures, and definitely one must look for brachial plexus or axillary, the brachial artery injury, as soon as you see a fracture dislocation. So a bit about all these problems. Which heads are really avascular? Hertel described the classification of proximal humeral fractures, the LEGO classification, and he postulated that whenever you have a disrupted posteromedial hinge or a metafascial beak less than 8 millimeters, then these heads are at risk of AVN. So like the anatomic neck fractures where there's absolutely no soft tissue attachment, no posteromedial hinge. So you look at the hinge on a CT scan. The X-ray may not show you correctly. If you see this, there is a hinge here. There's a good amount of hinge here. This is a viable, this head is going to remain viable in spite of dislocation. Whereas something like this, where there is nothing medially, may not remain viable. So this is type 2, and this was type 1. He also published another good paper as predictors of humeral head ischemia, basically talking about the same thing. If the head is far too laterally, anterolaterally displaced, which is rather rare, it is usually anteromedially displaced, where there is no extent, no medial beak less than 8 millimeters, then these are the potential avascular heads. Another good paper, JBJ's 2016, again, the same thing, extra-articular posteromedial bony spike is a good prognostic factor for head perfusion. Even though the head becomes avascular, it may not be symptomatic in the long run. And in most of the young patients where you have a medial beak, there is complete revascularization of the head by creeping substitution. What is mandatory for the head to revascularize is a good reduction within the glenoid and a stable fixation to the shaft. So what is the ideal timing? About 24 to 48 hours, ideally. I always use the deltopectoral approach. I don't think one can do this through the deltoid split because the head is usually far too medial. use the rotator interval to approach the capsule and do an arthrotomy. Biceps tendon is a very important landmark, which I always do a tenotomy in a fracture dislocation situation, because that is going to prevent your reduction of the head back to the glenoid. So I electively cut off the long head of biceps and tenodesit anteriorly later on. With that, you direct your arthrotomy towards the superior glenoid pole, which will show you the empty glenoid, but between the rotator interval, between the two tuberosities, after you have tagged them, you can safely open the joint, identify the radial head lying anteromedially, and then there are various methods of reducing the head. If you're doing it within the first 24 to 48 hours, it should not be very difficult to get it gently by levering it out from wherever it is lying under the glenoid, usually anterior and inferior to the glenoid, by blunt spikes or even simple artery forceps. You need to be extremely gentle because you are treading very close to the axillary artery, the brachial artery, as well as the brachial plexus. Another trick, especially if your bone quality is good, is to pass a 3.5 shands and gently wiggle out that head back into its place. Or if you just can't get the head back in spite of doing the tenotomy, in spite of trying to maneuver the head back into the glenoid, then, and especially in late cases, I have done this in two cases. You osteotomize the coracoid, and along with the attachments, the short head, the coracobrachialis, you take everything down. So once you retract everything down, then there's nothing. You just open the subscap and the head is lying there. But always, always be careful about the brachial artery and the plexus. We have had one such incidence in my institute where while trying to get the head back into the humerus, it was extremely difficult, more than 3 weeks old case, a very reputed surgeon doing it. And there was a vascular injury which required microvascular repair. So you need to be extremely careful in anterior fracture dislocations not to damage the neurovascular bundle. After reduction, you fill the metafascial void in the bone and in the neck with either allografts or bone grafts or bone substitutes, whatever is available. You may, if it is very unstable and a very small head, temporarily transfix it to the glenoid in the right rotation and then build up the metaphysis and the shaft over it. I have done this with a 1.5 millimeter K wire temporarily, and then you can build up the entire metaphysis over it. Whatever you do, prevent varus during fixation. This has been adequately stressed upon. Then you resuture the capsule, repair the labrum if required, and then tenodesize the long head of biceps. You have three options in these kind of injuries. The favored one is, of course, plating. And then in older or geriatric patients, you have the option of hemi as well as the reverse shoulder arthroplasty. So a few examples. This was a young male fall from a bike, three-part fracture dislocation, the head lying anteriorly. This is immediate post-op, 6 months post-op. And this is his function at 6 months. Reasonably good function. Another example, a 43-year-old male, again, a motor vehicle accident, presented within 48 hours. Here, a polyaxial lock plate with TCP blocks was used. And this is where the Arthrex polyaxial plate is useful, because then you can direct your screws very well, both in the calcar as well as wherever the bone stock is good. And I found this pretty useful, especially in porotic individuals. And this is at 6 months. This was a 50-year-old policeman fall from bike. This is the CT, and this is the post-op, immediate post-op X-ray. You can see that there is a little bit of angulation in the lateral view, but the tuberosities have been sutured back, and this is 6 weeks and 3 months post-op. A small piece of tuberosity seems to have slipped up here, but then his function was reasonably good. This is the most recently done case, 65-year-old, a four-part fracture, hit by a car. This was his CT, and you can see that the head is lying anteriorly. had a tough time getting it back in spite of all the tricks in the trade. And being 65 year old, I could not really fiddle too much with the head. I had kept a hemi as a backup, but this was the reduction in drop. I had to use a separate screw into the head through the tuberosity to manage that. This was the immediate post-op. I do not have his follow-up. It's just recently being done. Now, a word about replacement in these fractures. Replacement is going to be the next lecture, so I'm not going to go into the details of it. But indicated in type 2 fractures, Robinson's dislocations in elderly or late presentations, more than 3 weeks. Out of the two, which is better? Most of the recent papers, 2014 onwards, seem to favor the reverse shoulder better than the hemi in the elderly. And I think Dr. Mohan would enlighten us more about which is a better kind of arthroplasty in such cases. So treatment guidelines, all type 1 fracture dislocations, irrespective of the age, open reduction and fixation with a plate is preferred. Type 2 in younger patients, definitely preserve the head and fix it. I would go ahead and say that even if the head is split at times, I have reconstructed it on the table using Herbert screws and fixed it back onto the remaining shaft and sutured the tuberosities back in place. And those patients have done well. Type 2 in older patients above 65 years of age, where the cuff is already poor, reverse shoulder seems to be a promising option. More literature is coming up on that. In the intermediate age group between 55 and 65, that is where the hemi replacement seems to be doing well, but it's a controversial topic whether reverse or hemi is better in such situations. So to conclude, fracture dislocations are rare but not uncommon. Ideally should be treated between 24 to 48 hours to keep the head viable. Deltopectoral approach is the workhorse in such cases. Mandatorily or electively do a long head of biceps sternotomy. Do a gentle reduction of the head. Don't crush it. Don't damage the neurovascular structures. Stable fixation is better than replacement across all the age groups, across the entire literature. In the elderly, reverse shoulder seems to be more promising than hemi. But something which we are really worried of, avascular necrosis, is not very common and definitely not very symptomatic. Thank you.
Thank you, Chetan. Once again, can you stepwise summarize how will you reduce a head which has displaced, which has fractured and displaced anteriorly? How will you bring it back in glenoid? Stepwise, can you summarize once again?
Yes, so you take a deltopectoral approach and get the tuberosities away, go through the rotator interval, identify the bilateral, because you will add the fracture dislocation of the glenoid.
Can you stop your video? Your audio is not clear. Yeah.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes. Very clear.
Right. So you identify the single most important landmark, which is the long head of biceps. You tag it and you cut it off, keep it aside. That tendon itself will direct you where your arthrotomy should be, unless, of course, the capsule is so badly torn that everything is visible in front of you. So you open the capsule, clear the joint, give lavage, and then through the same interval, you can feel the head. Now, most often with adequate retraction and blunt instruments, you can get the head back into the glenoid, especially if you're doing it within 24 to 48 hours. If you cannot get it back, then I frequently use a 3.5 millimeter shant screw under Siam to go into the head and then wiggle the head out into the glenoid and fix it to the glenoid, transfix it to the glenoid in the correct rotation. So the head facing the dish facing the ball like that, and then build up the rest of the fracture on this transfixed head. That is a technique which I have followed when it was a very unstable situation. So these are the three. And in the last option, when you just cannot get it back and nothing is possible, then I would say a last resort would be a coracoid osteotomy and fragment with the attachments.
Okay. Asim, Vivek, Mohan, any different view on that?
May I ask one question, sir?
So we will finish this topic first on the method of reduction. Any different view or anything you want to add? Mohan,
no.
Vivek,
no,
Asim?
No.
Asim? So we follow the same, almost all the steps. Dr. Vasudev?
Yeah, sometime it is possible that the when the capsular attachment is not there. So when you manipulate that, actually it rotates here and there inside the that particular fracture zone.
Yes.
So in that case, what type of a trick you do to stabilize the humeral head so that you can align the rest of the fragment? That is how it is. Because if you use the sans pins also, and sometimes doing maneuvering also, the spansin, that sans pin also gets displaced. So in a situation, what type of a trick you use to stabilize the humeral head against the glenoid?
Sir, you will have to reduce it back and get the orientation of the head with the glenoid by eyeballing it and confirming it under the C-arm. And once you are sure of that piece being in its place fairly well, then transfix it to the glenoid temporarily.
That's what I wanted to get it from you. That sometime it needs to be transfixed to the glenoid, and then it is possible to keep this.
Because it is highly mobile, and it is because being cartilage all over, it is very, it can easily rotate here and there. Any other tricks, Sangeet? Maybe you can.
No, it is more or less the same. I was asking about the coracoid tenotomy, which you already covered up. And usually there is a button holing of the long head of biceps. So tenotomy is a must.
Yeah.
Right.
Sangeet, can I ask another question?
Yes, somebody,
if it is an unreduced for a few weeks, at that time routinely worthwhile doing a CT angio to kind of make sure that to analyze the proximity of the head.
Excellent. Suggestion, Vivek.
Yeah.
So now, something, yeah. Because it is very close to the neurovascular bundle, both.
Yeah.
Yes. All the shoulder surgeons in my institute do follow that. And okay. We also nowadays in late cases do a CT angio because it's a very, very valid suggestion. You're very close to the vessels.
So can we move to the next topic? So can we move to the next topic?
Yes, sure.
So we discussed earlier about the anterior fracture dislocation. Now we discuss the posterior fracture dislocation. Again, like the anterior, this is also a very rare injury, and it is seen in almost 2-5% of all fracture dislocation. It is associated with impacted fracture of the humeral head. Like in anterior dislocation, we have the posterior Hill sacs, and in a posterior dislocation, we have a reverse Hill sac, that is impacted fracture on the anterior side of the humeral head. It is often initially misdiagnosed, and it is considered as a frozen shoulder or a post-traumatic stiffness. And the amount of misdiagnosis is almost to the tune of 80%. The history, usually most of them, those who follow trauma, have a fall on an outstretched hand, and the percentage is almost 67%. And atraumatic causes like a seizure disorder or an electric shock represents 33%. The clinical examination, as it is missed, the patients may present late, where the element of pain will not be there. But if it is acute, they often come with the pain, restricted movement. The arm is locked in internal rotation and adduction, and there is no active or passive external rotation. They often have a stiff shoulder, and there is a fullness of shoulder posteriorly, and those which present late have a significant deltoid atrophy. The cause is an imbalance of muscle, That is, there is an involuntary muscle contraction. That is the strong internal rotators, the latissimus dorsi, the pec major, subscapularis, and the teres major. They overpower the weak external rotators, that is the infraspinatus and the teres minor. How do you diagnose them? The plain X-rays, again, the possibility of missing in a normal AP view if it is not taken properly. This is the normal AP view where you should see the joint space clearly and the relation of the humeral head and the glenoid. In a posterior dislocation, you will see a vacant glenoid, or there will be some overlap if it is a true AP view. And the axillary view is almost diagnostic, where you see the head fragment posteriorly to the glenoid, or it may be locked like this in this situation, and there is an impression or an impacted fracture anteriorly. So this is almost diagnostic radiological sign. The other things what can be helpful is in an anterior dislocation, even though you see an empty glenoid, but the full head is covering the anterior part of the glenoid. And this is the normal X-ray, how it should look like. And in a posterior dislocation, you can see there is small overlap, that is a crescent sign. Also, the head appears like a pear shape, or it is like a light bulb, unlike a normal humeral head in a posterior dislocation. Sometimes you may see an impaction fracture, and that can be impression, anterior impression, a second line which is representing that. That is a trough line which represents an impaction fracture. 2D CT and 3D CT both are equally important, because there is a high number of surgical neck fracture which are associated with posterior dislocation. These are almost more than 50%, or there may be associated fracture of lesser tuberosity, which is 42%, or the greater, which is almost 23%. Also, what is the relation of the humeral head to the glenoid? The anterior part of the humeral head is inside the glenoid, and the posterior part remains outside the glenoid. The 2D CT image, which is most important, delineates. This is a normal view, and you can see here that is the impression fracture, and that fragment is locked posteriorly, which is not allowing the reduction. So this is the bicipital groove, and the area where you have this impacted fractures can be defined if you take this cut, which shows the humeral head and the glenoid clearly. So the incidence of a reverse Hill-Sachs lesion is almost 86%, and that can be classified. These impression fractures or the reverse Hill-Sachs can be classified, and it will help in management. So the size of the defect decides whether these defects are less than 25% of the articular surface of the head, like in this first picture, or they are medium sized defect, which is about 25 to 50%, or a large defect, which involves more than 50%, because the treatment differs in each these three types of articular defects. To summarize why CT is important, once you know whether it is acute or chronic, it can diagnose the reverse Hill-Sachs lesion, which can define whether it is small, medium, or large defect, or if there are associated surgical neck fractures or lesser tuberosity fractures or greater tuberosity fractures. So CT scan in posterior dislocations are very important. So the treatment consists of either conservative treatment, where in elderly who have low functional demand, we can do a supervised neglect. Often those who have epilepsy or uncontrolled fits, who will not be complying with the treatment, can also be conserved. A close reduction can be tried. I'll come to it again. And the surgical management is either a non-anatomic or anatomic reconstruction of the reverse Hill-Sachs lesion after you have reduced it. And these includes the McLaughlin technique, using an allograft to fill the defect, or you do a rotation osteotomy and change the surface which articulates with the glenoid, or do an arthroplasty. the close reduction, if the defect on the humeral head is less than 25% of the articular surface and the duration of the dislocation is less than 3 weeks, we can try a attempt for close reduction. And how do we do it? Under general anesthesia and muscle relaxant, a gentle reduction is attempted by flexing and adducting the affected limb and then giving an axial traction on the arm. And direct pressure to the humeral head from behind can facilitate the reduction. So giving a traction, adduction, and internal rotation, and then posteriorly pushing the humeral head into the glenoid may sometimes reduce that. Often, you have to unlock. If this maneuver doesn't work, you have to unlock. That is, you do a gentle internal rotation, which will help to stretch out the posterior capsule and the rotator cuff, and then give a lateral traction so that the head is unlocked from the glenoid and then externally rotate so that the head is reduced in the glenoid. And then the arm is immobilized in external rotation of about 20 degrees for about 6 weeks. And then you start a normal physiotherapy. I'll give you two examples, case examples. This is a 59 years old individual. He fell down from the bed on the left shoulder. He had old history of epilepsy. He's a chartered accountant by profession and he's right-handed. And he was doing all the possible activities with this hand. Posterior dislocation, you can see a crescent sign there, and the axillary view, you can see it is locked posteriorly. So there is no way, and the impacted head, the size is quite large. It is more than 25%. So here we tried close reduction, but it was not possible as the head was locked like this. And the amount of reverse Hill sacs is about more than 25%. And it is considered as a risk factor for the avascular necrosis in these posterior dislocation fracture. If you do not treat this reverse Hill sacs, then there is a very high chance they will also undergo a recurrent problem of having a recurrent dislocations. So CT scan defines what size of the defect it is on the humeral head. And the treatment is by a standard deltopectoral approach, identify the biceps tendon as we did for anterior dislocation also, which is used as a reference point because on the lateral side is your greater tuberosity, on the medial side is your lesser tuberosity. So we have to work on the medial side of the tendon. The upper margin of the subscapularis tendon is divided to have an access in the dislocation, and it allows a better visualization. It also allows to know what size of the fragment, what is its relation to the subscapularis tendon, and then gradually do a lateral distraction and externally rotate, giving a pressure posteriorly. So this will reduce the posterior dislocation. You can use a lever, a bone lever through the defect to reduce that dislocation. And that is how, once you reduce it, you can hold the large lesser tuberosity and the fragment with the help of a K wire, and that anterior large fragment, which is here, we can take a suture fixed with a lag screw and suture in the footprint. So no transfer of the subscapularis is required here because the fragment is large and it can be reposed back in its normal position. So that is the defect on the humeral head after reduction. And that is that fragment which was impacted has been delivered out and reduced like this and then sutured to the plate and with the screw, and that is the lateral view. These are the three screws fixing that large fragment which is anteriorly. And this is his post-op x-ray. And at 2 years, there is no avascular necrosis. The fracture has healed completely. And he has a good range of movement and he's able to do most of his activities. So in this case, the fragment was large. It did not require a transfer, and it healed in an acceptable position, and patient has a good function. Another situation where the patient usually presents late. He presented at 4 months. He was treated by a quack. He presented with restricted range of movement. He had no pain. The shoulder was stiff. The arm was locked in about 40 degrees of internal rotation. Here also, you can see a similar picture in the axillary view, but you as well see there is a large head fragment which has separated from the shaft. And on the CT, which we have a glenoid subtraction view, you can see the head is not in a normal plane, what it should look like. It is gone posteriorly. It is retroverted excessively. The distance between the head and the shaft has also increased. And there is another fragment, which is anteriorly, that is this impacted fragment. So this is a fracture of the neck and a anterior impacted fragment both. And this is another view. We can see what is the relation of that fragment anteriorly. And in the CT, this is a normal CT of other individual. And you can see this is the bicipital groove, that fragment which should have been here in relation to the glenoid has gone posteriorly, and that represents a large humeral head. The plan was to do an osteotomy of that fragment and then bring it back, and then whatever is a defect left, that either we put an allograft or do a McLaughlin's transfer so that the humeral head appears normal. So we started with the deltopectoral approach, and you can see what is the relation of the humeral head to the lateral epicondyle. Normal, it is retroverted by about 19 degrees. So here, in relation to the epicondyle, the head has rotated almost by about 90 degrees. So the lesser tuberosity was released from the scar tissue and osteotomized. There was a release of scar tissue between the humeral head and the posterior glenoid rim. The humeral head was locked and had united posteriorly. So this is how it was after reduction. But there was a plane for us to go, which was visible on the C-arm. So the K-wire was used to locate that fragment and the plane of the malunion. And once we found out the plane, we did an osteotomy of the head through the plane, which is the original fracture plane. And then this is how it was reduced. There is a small video clip where that head fragment was then reduced to the shaft like this. And with the K-wires, the anatomy was a little bizarre here at this stage. So once we fixed the lesser tuberosity and fixed the head to the shaft, it was appearing normal. And that is how at the end, the picture looked like. The lesser tuberosity after the transfer in the defect, and then the head attached to the shaft looked like this. That is what we did. The lesser tuberosity, which was here, was transferred in the defect, McLaughlin's procedure, and which was fixed by the screw here. This is at 6 months. And this is his picture at 6 months, where he has a good range of movement, a good external rotation and internal rotation and circumduction. This is at 18 months. The screw is loose, which is fixing the McLaughlin's procedure or the lesser tuberosity, but there is no avian. And finally, everything has healed well. So this is, we discussed two different cases. In a nutshell, this is the management of posterior shoulder dislocation, if it is acute or whether it is chronic. If it is chronic, in an elderly, the treatment is different. In an acute, if the fracture is visible, if it is visible, open reduction and treat the reverse Hill sacs as we have discussed. If it is less than 20%, you can use a posterior approach also, and the Bankart repair or the modified Maglogleen's procedure can be done. If it is more than 20 to 40% anterior approach, you can use an allograft disimpact as we what did in the first case, and the lesser tuberosity transfer or the subscaps transfer can be done as we did in the second case. If the defect is more than 40%, you can do an anterior approach. You can use an allograft or an osteotomy or an arthroplasty if the age of the patient is elderly. If after close reduction, if it is reducible and if it is stable, then nothing is required. If it is unstable, then again, you have to address like the same. In an elderly, where there is a low demand of the patient, you can treat them conservatively. If there is a reverse Hill sac, which is large enough, more than 50%, always consider arthroplasty. So this was in nutshell about the treatment and how we manage the posterior fracture dislocation. Thank you. Any questions?
Wonderful presentation, Sangeet. Actually, I have listened to you this lecture for at least 4 times. This is the 5th time, I think so. But there is something to gain from your knowledge. But I want to ask one question to you. How often do you require a 2-incision, anterior as well as posterior, in some difficult cases?
Sir, to be honest, everybody's experience is very small. And it is scary to open. If at all, if it is required, it is only for manipulating the head inside the glenoid, for aiding the reduction. It doesn't help us in any way. I have not done it myself.
Vivekji, do you have any experience of this thing?
No, sir. I have not. I have done 2 of these, fortunately, acute posterior, and that has been my case. So I have not done many.
Okay. Mohanji, do you have any experience of 2-incision?
I have no experience with the posterior dislocation management.
So, Negi Saab.
Unmute. Asim, unmute.
No, sir. I do it with the deltopectoral as Sangeet has done.
I have one time faced with the difficulty. I used 2-incision. Fortunately, the anatomical reduction was perfect. Radiological X-ray was perfect. But ultimately, that patient developed after 9 months avascular necrosis, and he is a young chap. So probably the 2-incision theory is very devastating, and probably it compromised the blood supply anteriorly as well as posteriorly. That was my experience, but I don't know how far it is true. But 2-incision theory posteriorly, if you give a very small incision, the reduction, it becomes very simple. That's what I want to convey.
I have taken 2-incision in an obese patient almost 5 years back when we were doing the 4-part with deltopectoral. So it was simply impossible to catch hold of the greater tuberosity. To just suture that greater tuberosity, a separate incision was taken, and then the sutures were tunneled through the window and brought forward. So,
okay. So we'll go with the next lecture, Sangeet.
Yes, please. Mohan, can you share your screen and unmute yourself?
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. I think the last of this is hemiarthroplasty. Thanks, organizers. One second. I'm not able to. Yeah. Thanks, Dr. Sandeep Gawale. Thanks, Dr. Gadegone. Thanks, Dr. Ajit Shinde, for inviting me here for this talk. We'll go with this theme: indications, tips and tricks, design issues, survival, and the comparison with the other options which are available. So indications broadly are when stabilization of the humeral head is not visible and we are talking about the elderly patients, and when there is a high risk for humeral head necrosis. After all, the patient's own head is own head, and it's always preferable than to have anything which is artificial. But in these extreme cases where it is not possible, we may have to resort to orthoplasty. And this one of the options of orthoplasty is hemiorthoplasty. It can be four-part fracture humerus, fracture dislocations, displaced fracture of the anatomical neck, impacted fracture when the humeral head is more than 40% of the head. And there is a entity which you can diagnose perhaps on a 3D CT, which are called shield fractures, and these are unrecognized fractures extending into the humeral head, and these may be the indications perhaps of the for the hemiorthoplasty. I think this has already been covered. The Hertel's additional criteria for the perfusion of the head: medial metafacial head extension more or equal to 8 mm, and integrity of the medial hinge, which will decide the quality of the reduction and perfusion. And the another factor is osteoporosis. Tingart described this as a mean index or cortical thickness index, which is addition of medial and the lateral cortical thickness. If it is less than 4 mm, then perhaps orthoplasty may be a slightly better option than doing an osteosynthesis. So how do we go about pre-op radiological assessment? Pascal Beaulieu and Suman Krishnan described this of taking X-ray views with the ruler of both entire humeri, and this is for one to restore the normal humeral health. And for the purist, we have to take a CT scan of both the sides. This will tell us the number of fragments and the size of the humeral head on the affected side, compare it with the opposite side, retroversion of the humeral head on from the opposite side, the neck shaft angle, and if there is any fatty infiltration of the rotator cuff. So this is the way you would calculate, and you would also calculate the with the magnification marker there. So length of the normal humerus and length of the fracture there, the fracture, and you mark that on the actual prosthesis implant, and keep prosthesis proud in that that much. So this has already been highlighted, Gothic arch on the normal side, and we have to restore it on the affected side. So putting a prosthesis is not just putting a spacer just like that, but it involves more of a osteosynthesis of the tuberosity, and that is the most important part of the performing the hemiorthoplasty. Execution of planning interop would be to restore the Gothic arch, and you need to keep the implant proud that much, take multiple sutures and get the tuberosity back. There are templates available with various companies. This is Evolutis. You have a template, you can template place the template against the fracture site, and there are markers on the templates, which are also markers on the brooch. These are unique trauma RAS. There is a 0, 5, 10 and 15, and you can keep the prosthesis proud that much. So it is important to select the proper or appropriate design for the prosthesis. If it does not match the native anatomy, then there can be problem, and this problem can be in the coronal plane as well as in the axial plane. So what will happen if you do not restore the inclination and medial offset of the native humerus in the coronal plane? If as regards the inclination, if you go wrong, there can be subacromial impingement, there can be superior bulging of the prosthetic head. If your medial offset goes wrong, then there can be a glenoid or posterior impingement or inferior sliding of the prosthetic head. If there is a retroversion, what will happen is there is coracoid impingement, and not only that, the greater tuberosity repair may be in, put on lot of strain, and there can be tuberosity escape. If the posterior offset goes wrong, then there can be anterior posterior instability, and there are surgeon controllable variables. If the prosthesis does not match the actual or native anatomy, then you can cheat away slightly here and there by putting the prosthesis in slight varus, or you can have medial lateral translation. I will show you in the next few slides there, or you can increase the retroversion, or you can have anterior posterior translation. So The ideal is to use a platform system for easy conversion or revision at a later date. The advantage, we were discussing whether we do hemiarthroplasty or reverse shoulder. The only advantage of perhaps performing a hemiarthroplasty is you don't burn the bridges, whereas you are already at the top of the pyramid when you are doing a reverse shoulder, and there is nothing further to offer other than a revision reverse shoulder, whereas you can always convert the hemi into a reverse if that fails. And perhaps in the middle age people, less than 70, as we said, between 60 to 70 or 55 to 70, that may be an option. Modular, because it can match the native anatomy as far as possible, and it should be tuberosity friendly, because the success of the hemiarthroplasty will depend upon the tuberosity osteosynthesis in a native position and tuberosity union. And I am going to reiterate this again and again for the benefit of our junior colleagues who are listening to this talk. So there are several parameters of native humeral head. You have head height, you have offset, which is a medial offset and a posterior offset, and we have radius of curvature, and we have all these parameters have to match. And it is, many times it is difficult to do this when we are using a monoblock non-modular prosthesis. If you have straight canal filling stem, you can really damage the supraspinatus and it can really rip off, and the results are obviously going to get compromised. Your native humerus does not match that of the prosthesis, you can cheat a little bit. You can use a narrow stem prosthesis, and the medial offset is not maintained, you can put in slight varus, or you can translate it medially to maintain this medial offset. In the coronal plane, the posterior offset is not matching, then you can translate this posteriorly, or you can increase the retroversion. But there is a risk of doing this again, because if you increase the retroversion, again the greater tuberosity may not unite, the greater tuberosity to the shaft union may be put to lot of strain. So you can cheat to some extent, but here again the modular stems and the fracture specific stems do help. These are the modular stems of DePuy, global fracture stem, which can have a possibility of putting it having change in the inclination, valgus, neutral or varus inclination and tilt in the coronal plane. The technique is beach chair position with a C-arm, but one should not give more than 45 degree elevation, because if you are there are steep positions, there are problems of cerebral circulation, there is a bradycardia, hypotension, and these should be avoided as far as possible. The incision may be either deltopectoral or superolateral. Again, superolateral, you can perform hemiarthroplasty, there is no problem. In fact, it is easy, because you can tie the tuberosities better. So, the superolateral, it is simple. Your exposure of glenoid is not a problem. Suture of the tuberosity is more easy. You respect the subscap, but you have to cut through the deltoid, and if we have to cut bone if the cuff is intact. Whereas deltopectoral is a more common approach. We respect the deltoid muscle and supraspinatus. You can control the axillary nerve. Humeral preparation is easy, and the problem is again the subscap management, and here glenoid exposure in the hemi is not a question or not a concern while performing a hemiarthroplasty. We have various gauges available. There are two parameters of the head. One is head height and other is diameter, and they have fixed ratio of around 0.7 to 0.9 to each other. So head is available, head height, it is 15 mm, 18 mm and 21 mm in one of the systems, and you have diameters of 44, 48 and 52, and you can, like a AMR gauge, you can literally place the humeral head after excision, and you can place it and match that with the template and select the right size. So it has to be modular, it has to be platform system, and you measure the head and plan the try and match the native anatomy. Charles Neer actually described the hemiarthroplasty for fractures, and this was way back in 1951. And he is reportable, he was a master surgeon, he reported acceptable function in almost 90% of the patients at 20 years. But later, many authors could not reproduce these results. The pain relief was predictable, but the function was unpredictable in many other master surgeons all over the world. So there was a debate continuously whether to use a conventional stem or a separate stem, which is a fracture stem. So this is a fracture stem where it's proximally, it is of low profile. It has holes for anchorage of the tuberosities. It is a porous coated or HA coated for tuberosities to integrate it very well. And again, as I told you, here you can match the, it's a modular system, and there are almost four slots here where you can put in the humeral head, and you have you can change the antiversion. So almost 64 permutations combinations possible in this system. So in the Neer's first generation of implants, the head was often malpositioned in both vertical and horizontal plane as compared to the native anatomy, and head was often oversized. That's why there was a need for the second generation of the implants. So first generation was monoblock, non-modular. Second generation was modular. We have this available even now, which is example is global from Depoy. Third generation prosthesis where it's modular and adaptable variable version and offset and inclination, which we do not have it here presently. Aquilis from Tournier and anatomical shoulder system from Zimmer. And fourth generation prosthesis, we have modular and in situ adjustability, which is Equinox, which is unfortunately is not in the, it was there, but it's again taken off the market from the Exotech company. And compare these with the present generation of implants here in market, rampant in our part of the country. And these are non-modular and non-anatomical. They do not respect the tuberosities. And these are from, I won't name the companies, but you must have seen these. And one of the companies have even made a bipolar prosthesis out of this. So, and the worst is the fourth right side, this sort of a prosthesis. And I can show you what happens. You know, this was a fracture, which was four part fracture, for which this prosthesis was done, looked okay initially. The tuberosities are too low down. This is 6 months, and that is at 1 year. It has ripped off the rotator cuff, and it is almost articulating with the undersurface of the acromion. Patient is very, very painful with no range of movement. So, so there was a need for the trauma stem, which is dedicated, and there are various trauma stems available in the market. This is for the tuberosities to heal, and you can take these sutures, and these have to be non-absorbable of good strength. Here we have tied the ethibond, but there are orthocord and other fiber wire or fiber tape are available where you can suture these tuberosities together. And your ultimate aim is not just to put in a spacer like thing or a ball there, but for you should have the tuberosities united in a right function if one wants the patient to have active elevation more than 120 degrees. So this is a right side is a conventional stem where you don't require a graft there. Left side is a low profile dedicated fracture stem, and you can put in a graft there. These are many times coated, and this lateralizes the greater tuberosity. So you have to maintain the head height, restoration of the gothic arch, and the tuberosities have to unite in correct position. So this was well emphasized by these articles in CORE 2011 and Journal of Shoulder and Elbow Surgeries in 2013. So same thing again, this is what is gothic arch. You confirm this in the intrafluoroscopy. Or the other way to know how proud you can keep the prosthesis is the insertion of the pectoralis major. It should be around 5.6 centimeters proximal, or the head height, which again has already been mentioned before. Ideally it is around 8 mm. But anything less than 3 mm or more than 20 mm is associated with a poor outcome. So if you sink it too low, it's bad. If you keep it, it should be just right. If it is too high, there is what is described as unhappy triad in connection with the hemiorthoplasty. Two high stem, two retrovertebral processes, and two low or two distal greater tuberosity anchorage. This is associated with a failure. There are jigs available for aligning it or keeping the stem length or maintaining the fracture length. These are available commercially. And increase head to tuberosity distance, there are causes. One is if you keep the humeral stem too proud, or if you use a too thick head segment, or if one pulls the tuberosity too distally. And this is possible if the tuberosities are comminuted. This is like over reducing the tuberosity distal to the their anatomical attachment, and this would fail ultimately. Tuberosity malreduction can be the another cause is keeping the humeral head in excessive retroversion. So normal retroversion is described as 30 degree retroversion in relation to the epicondylar axis, but this we don't measure. What we see is the forearm axis. So when we keep the elbow in 90 degree flexion and keep the forearm in full supination, there are pins available, and you keep it around 20 degree retroversion. Or another way of keeping the right version is you have to face the prosthetic glenoid facing the native glenoid, prosthetic humeral head facing the native glenoid when the forearm is in neutral rotation. So that is another way of checking the right version. If you put it in excessive version, then what will happen is you will be able to tie the greater tuberosity to the shaft, but you will have to do it in external rotation. And when we immobilize the limb in the way we usually do, in adduction and internal rotation, there would be too much strain on this repair and the tuberosities will fly off. So that's the cause of repair. Suture should be through the tendons rather through the tuberosities, because here the soft tissues are firm there, and bones are usually osteoporotic, and the sutures will cut through. So in summary, the landmarks for hemiarthroplasty position is your height should be less than 1 centimeter lengthening, less than 1 centimeter shortening of the whole humerus X-ray. Head summit to the superior edge of the pectoralis major should be around 5.5 centimeters. You should restore the medial Gothic arch. Retroversion should be 20 degrees as in context with the forearm axis. And the other way is implant head facing the glenoid cavity when the forearm is kept in the neutral rotation, or arm is kept in the neutral rotation. Tuberosity head summit to the superior edge of the greater tuberosity should be around 5 to 10 mm. And we should lateralize, or lateral offset of the tuberosity should be matching the native way. So in short, when you do a tuberosity closure, which is important, and I am repeating again and again, is that you should take tuberosity to tuberosity stitch. You should take tuberosity to stem stitches and tuberosity to shaft, and these should be in the horizontal as well as vertical manner. Horizontal means it should be circumferential so as to avoid the escape of this tuberosity, and that is one of the way. This is a rare sort of a situation for me to display, because if it heals in an anatomical position, you get perfect function or perfect full range of movement, whereas here you have the GT is united, but there is a escape of the lesser tuberosity even when we have used the fracture stem. So this can happen if the bone is too porotic and comminuted. Tuberosity migration even in the expert science is almost as high as 50%. So postoperatively, delayed mobilization is advised as long as 4 weeks and 6 weeks. We keep it in the sling, just gentle mobilization of the elbow and the hand, and passive mobilization. But because early mobilization results in the unsatisfactory results, superior migration or prosthesis, if there is a tuberosity migration, there is a stiffness and weakness and persistent pain if there is a tuberosity migration. There is no difference of delayed mobilization results and the early mobilization if you mobilize within 2 weeks. So there are papers on this. The main complication of these are mainly the tuberosity migration, very high tuberosity non-union and tuberosity malunion, and the other complications are as common as in other surgeries, infection, axillary palsy, dislocations, glenoid wear in long run, and revision for the glenoid wear. So outcome of shoulder hemi, in short, depend upon the precise prosthetic implantation, and the most important is augmented osteosynthesis of the tuberosities, which would result in an anatomical reconstruction. And this is important if one has to get the overhead elevation more than 120 degrees. If we compare the results of hemi versus reverse, the abduction is far better in the reverse shoulder. Forward elevation is far better. This is from the meta-analysis and review papers or systematic review. Forward elevation is far better in reverse shoulder. External rotation, as regards external rotation, hemi orthoplasty and reverse, there is no difference. As regards the survival, even in the young, we would not advise, again I would like to reiterate that you would not advise hemi orthoplasty in young patients, but where it is not avoidable and you have done this hemi orthoplasty, 5-year survival is around 91%, 10-year is around 82%, 15 years is around 78% and 20 years is 75%. The trauma results, the hemi orthoplasty done for the trauma are obviously have poor results, and those hemi orthoplasties done for failed fixation have poorer results than done for the acute fractures. So if you compare the three modalities, it's like comparing apples with the oranges. Having person's own humeral head is always preferable. However, if we compare the open reduction as regards active forward flexion, surprisingly, this paper from Mark Frankel suggests that active elevation is more in fact, a hemi orthoplasty than in open reduction or in reverse shoulder. But this is perhaps, and this one is an exceptional paper. Overall, if you see the outcome of hemi, patient satisfaction is very good, almost as high as 81%. Mean active forward flexion one would expect to get would be around 90, not more than not overhead abduction. Simple shoulder tests would be around 8 to 10. Pain relief would be to the tune of 84%. Many times these would be rotator cuff deficient patient, and perhaps this was from one of the papers. Out of 32, only one patient stated that he could resume normal activities. So these patients usually do not go back to their baseline normal, though the pain relief is good. So it is a technically demanding procedure with a variable outcome. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mohan Desai. Dr. Gadigone is looking at the watch repeatedly.
No.
We will have to wind up. But before that, I'll put a question. Which is common for orthopedic surgeon in an elderly. How do you decide which patient requires a hemi, which requires a total, and which requires a reverse?
Can I kickstart this?
Yes.
So I think generally we are trauma surgeons and we are geared to do trauma surgery. It is all fine to say hemi arthroplasty versus reverse versus fixation. This is better. Now we are looking at centers. We are doing high volume. There are arthroplasty surgeons who are doing good work in terms of reverse as well as hemi. The thing to ask is, as an individual surgeon, the man who is in his nursing home, does his result of an arthroplasty match what is given in the published result? And to me, I think as trauma surgeons, we are good reconstructive surgeons and we are trained to do good reconstructive work. So I think generally the idea should be that you need to kind of preserve the humeral head in every which way possible. If you don't have an allograft, you should go and take a fibular strut. If you don't have that, you take an iliac crest. But every attempt, no matter whatever the age, unless of course it's a very bad split and a 70-year-old that you have poor osteoporotic bone, then it's a different indication altogether. But most of us are trained to do 80% or 90% of our work in reconstruction. So it's all fair and well to say that reverse is doing good results. And if you're not, you're doing one reverse shoulder maybe in every 3 or 4 years, then I think it is, you have to kind of be good, a good trauma surgeon to give consistently good results is all I can think
point,
of summarizing.
Point taken. Do what is best in your hands. Right. Mohan.
Yeah, I think I fully agree with Dr. Vivek that you should master the technique of reconstruction, osteosynthesis, and that is always better. Cost effective, you don't burn the bridges, and you can always, you can have fall-off option of, doing, later surgery. But as a, if you do a reverse, there is no falling back option. And the complications are, though the results are high, complications are also high. There are many complications, so scapular notching and glenoid loosening and so on and so forth. So, and there is no fallback option. So, but in a 70-year-old, very osteoporotic, I cannot reconsider. I would rather than going for the hemiarthroplasty, I would opt for the reverse shoulder straight away, because I am comfortable doing a reverse shoulder. But I think the surgeons like Dr. Vivek, Dr. Chetan, you yourself, Dr. Vasudev Gadu, I think in your hands, I think the reconstruction would be far better. And if it fails, maybe in few, even if the head is avascular, the outcome in non-weight bearing joint like this won't be bad. In fact, I have a video, small video, where there is a proffer trial. Leaving it alone is a good option for this, and I have a video showing that is a malunited tuberosities, perfectly acceptable function.
So to conclude, the indication of reverse shoulder is when your rotators are deficient, and that is the reason Dr. Mohan Desai has stressed repeatedly, if your shoulders are deficient, your hemi replacements are not, is not going to work. And that is the reason he's saying again and again that the tuberosity, which represents the rotator cuff, has to be sutured, and you must make every attempt so that they unite to each other, not only to each other, but also to the shaft, to have a good result of hemi replacement. If you don't reconstruct the tuberosity, your results are going to be bad. Am I right, Dr. Mohan?
Yes, yes, Sangeet. Yeah, fully agree.
And the most often in these elderly, you must usually take a history whether they had a functioning rotator cuff. If they have a deficient rotator cuff, again, probably in those who have fractures, hemi is not going to work. So to conclude, that was all about fracture dislocation, hemi replacement, the split deltoid approach, and the dislocations. So over to you, Dr. Vasudev, sir.
So to conclude, actually, it is a very, very good webinar, I can say. How many people they are watching, it's not the matter. But we have discussed out each and every point. And not only that, the viewers will learn, but I have learned many things and to improve our surgical skill. I thank very much Dr. Sangeet Gawale for a very wonderful moderation. I always you do it. Dr. Ajit Shinde is still, he's here on the chair to witness our webinar. Dr. Vivek Shetty, Dr. Chetan Pradhan, Dr. Mohan Desai and Asim Negi. They are all masters of masters, and they have displayed their knowledge brilliantly. And this webinar will be a most wonderful webinar which has happened, and that will be most beneficial to the younger as well as a senior person. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for being with us, for continuing our academic activity at Maharashtra Orthopedic Association under the leadership of our friend Ajit Shinde. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you, Asim bhai.